Thank you.
Do I sound all raspy?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh. I don't hear anything.
Are you there? Well, I'm waiting for Julia to come back. And while I'm waiting for her, I can show you this picture. This is the picture that I used for my short story, F. I think she's going to change devices now. Okay, you're kind of sideways.
Okay, I'm trying to fix it. Let's see. Now am I okay?
No, you're still sideways.
Can I fix it?
No, I mean, I'm seeing you. So, oh, now it is. Now it's good. Now it's good.
That's funny that it did that one thing.
Okay. Okay, it's fine now.
I'm just trying to get it to stay. I'll have to hold it like that. Okay.
I guess you're doing this on your phone, right?
Yeah, I accepted it on the tablet earlier. That was a mistake. And then the tablet, it has that like agitated sound to it. So that's not going to work on there. So I'm just trying to get, okay, there we go. Now I can have the phone.
Okay, good. So,
and you can hear me okay? It doesn't sound raspy.
It's not raspy. It might not be quite as loud as I would like, but it's not raspy.
Maybe I can fix that. Let's try. So I think that's as loud as I'm going to get it.
That's okay.
Okay.
It's fine. My laptop does not have very good speakers, but you're fine.
Okay. Anyway, so we had a few topics that we wanted to talk about tonight. I know that our scheduled guests didn't work out, but there's still a lot of things we can discuss, correct?
Yes. Yes, I think there are quite a number of things. I, for one, am quite interested in finding out what's going on, what happened with the YouTube shooter, what did they do to her channel that made her so angry?
I read a little bit about it, and I know they were saying that she was mentally unstable, but she was upset because she was definitely mentally unstable, but she did have a point that they demonetized the video where she was just doing an ab workout, and she wasn't showing any, like, body, but when she called the YouTube Center about it, they said, no, your video is risque, and it's, but she was just actually doing an ab workout. I watched some of her content. It's a little different. She was a vegan, and she was one of those kind of militant vegans. But she still does have a point. They shouldn't have demonetized her account when she wasn't posting anything scantily clad. You know, that is a real, actual, valid issue. So what have you heard about it?
Well, actually, I know less than you. I was not able to view her content. I thought they had taken it all down. Is it still up?
Okay, what I did was I went, because I wanted to know what was going on this morning, so I just typed in YouTube shooter, and there were a few videos just posted where they had captured some of her content on these different channels reporting about it. So yeah, her content was all taken down. She does have a valid point that they were demonetizing videos that were not inappropriate. she did have some mental issues to do what she did, which was really horrible. But that still doesn't negate her valid point that why was her video demonetized when she was just doing an exercise video? That's a valid point. When there are like Miley Cyrus and Nicki Minaj and all the other people, like she said in one of her videos, they're not wearing clothing, but YouTube told her apparently that doing just like sit-ups, and she was fully clothed, by the way. Yeah, that was inappropriate, and they were right, and they stood by their decision. So I think it made her snap, and that's what happened. That's from the recording that I've heard anyway. So
right. No, I'm not trying to justify anything that she did.
Yeah.
I was just trying to understand what's going on with YouTube, because I think YouTube also has the problems, and you know, they seem to demonetize people for strange reasons, and sometimes they even censor people when they express opinions that they don't like. I mean, I heard that about Jordan Peterson, that at one point Google took down everything of his, including he couldn't get to his Gmail, you know, his mail account, his backed up content, not just his channel. And then after about 24 hours, they gave it back. But it's kind of scary that they can do that, because that can turn your life upside down.
Yeah, it really is. In the case of this woman, I need to go back and look for her name. I think it made her snap mentally, because she was mentally unstable, and she was to the point that she was just so upset that, like, she still does have a valid point. Why did they demonetize a video? Like, everything she did is so horrible, and she needed mental help. But why did they demonetize a video where she was doing sit-ups? Like, that's actually a pretty accurate point. I think it made her snap. Her father apparently called the police because she went missing, and he was worried about her, and he thought she was going to do something like this. But at the end of the day, like, I don't know why YouTube's demonetizing videos that are not inappropriate. And then if you ask them why, they're like, oh, we stand by our decision 100%, when you can look at the video and see that there wasn't really anything wrong with that particular video, you know? And she said some of the same things that you're saying that other person said, where she felt she was being censored about some of her opinions, and her videos were being taken down, I suppose. And she wasn't making that much money when she used to make much more money. And apparently she had 10,000 followers, but she only made 10 cents for 300,000 page views. So that was one of her upset points, was that she had 300,000 page views, but she only made 10 cents. That's what she said.
Right. No, I think she was much more successful than we are, I guess, in terms of attracting a viewership. And she had the subscribers that she needed. And so I'm just wondering why she was demonetized, because it doesn't make sense.
It doesn't make sense. I think this is just kind of what I'm getting, is that she wasn't popular among some of her other people, like in the expatriate community. And because her videos were a little different, they would send her messages. And I think it might have been some sort of personal feud. And it kind of sounds like maybe somebody like that didn't like her got her videos demonetized. I mean, I could be wrong, but that's kind of what it, I don't know. But she called the call hotline and asked, like, what's wrong with this video? And they stood by their decision. And it may not be a video that everybody wants to watch, but it wasn't inappropriate sexually the way that they told her it was. That was the part that is perplexing. Like, I don't know why they would stand by that decision. Why didn't they just re-monetize her video after watching it, after a human viewed it? She was doing sit-ups. It wasn't anything inappropriate. She was just doing sit-ups. Her content was very unusual. She's dancing with cows, saying protect farm animals. She's wearing these, like, animal... it was very different. But, you know, she has the right to post that content. But in the end, I feel very sorry for her, because there were some issues that she probably needed help with. But that was probably something her family should have addressed if they knew she was that in that sort of state, I wonder why they let her go off like that. Like,
well, they couldn't stop her. She was an adult, and they did call the,
they called the police. Yeah, they called the police. You're right.
And the thing is, the police found her sleeping in a car, but she wasn't hurting anybody at that time, so they let her go. And I think that was okay. I've heard all sorts of crazy things. I don't actually know the facts of this woman's case, but I've heard all sorts of crazy kind of reactions to hearing about the case. So I heard this one guy on the Rubin Report, he said, they should have arrested her because she was sleeping in her car. And I don't think so.
No, I don't think you should arrest them. Now, that's another point that really bothers me, is because a lot of people are homeless, and the only place that they have to live is their car. So why would it be a crime if the only place you have to live is your car? Because a lot of people can't afford housing. In her case, yeah, she... But so what? She wanted to stay in her car. That wasn't the issue. It's just... Right.
No.
They shouldn't have demonetized her account. It doesn't matter who you are. They... I guess it sent her over the edge, is what they said, that she lost it. So,
right, and of course, she did not have done what she did. I'm not in any way advocating for that. But on the other hand, this other thing is that nobody is mentioning the fact that she apparently did not have the right to have that gun in the state of California, and that this was a gun-free zone. So all those things that they were advocating for Parkland, you know, to have stronger gun restrictions, none of that would have helped in her case.
No, it wouldn't have. It wouldn't have. If somebody wants to do something bad, they're going to do it anyway. You can pass as many laws as you want. I mean, they're going to do what, I mean, I think it's a very isolated case, though, because even, okay, when they were looking at all these different shooters, very few of them are women. And one of the things that they were saying that was so strange about it was when they asked, they said, what's the man look like? Like, they were asking about the active shooter. They said, no, it's a woman. So, like, it's so rare. There's only been 3 women that did an active shooting case in the U.S. since 1980. So that's how isolated this event is. It just doesn't usually happen that a woman would go out and do that. So
I guess I was thinking of Squeaky Fromm, but that was probably before 1980. So,
well, you could be right. I'm just going off the CBS. Like, the only thing that I really know, maybe their statistics wrong. That's just what they mentioned. And then there was another YouTube channel that does all these like celebrity things. They talked about this. Like, I only could find a few things about her. There isn't a lot of information about it. There were some people that, okay, I think this tragedy is really horrible, but what they were like highlighting was, oh, her content wasn't good. And you can't expect to do well if you have strange content. And I thought, well, that's really not the point. The point is, why would you demonetize something if it wasn't sexual? That's the point, I think, that she was making.
Yeah, like, no. She was doing quite a bit better than we are so far. So, a lot of people apparently liked her crazy content, and if they like it and it doesn't hurt anybody, they I don't see why they have to demonetize it.
Yeah, exactly. Like, if she wasn't hurting anybody, I mean, ultimately she did, but maybe that decision sent her over the edge. I don't know all the details of her life and what, like, if there were other things going on, but it sounds like that was the event that triggered it in her mind. She just felt... Well, she also was, she was from Iran, and she was part of the Baha'i faith they mentioned. And she said that when she came to America, she felt like everything was really hard to adjust. So maybe she had some other issues, but it seems like this event is what sent her over the edge.
Well, mentioning the fact that she was Persian. I also heard somebody say that they thought that maybe the hardcore... You know, if you're Persian and you're in the United States, then in many cases you're running away from the persecution that's going on over there if you don't belong to the Muslim faith and don't do it correctly. So she did not cover her head. She looked, you know, she was dressed as a Westerner. And it's quite possible that if somebody, you know, if somebody decided to complain about her to YouTube, that would be somebody who objected to her non-Iranian kind of way of living or dress.
Yeah, that could, because she was getting popular in Iran too. You're probably right. I know she's very popular on the social media there, so maybe that's a good point.
Yeah, some of her broadcasts were actually in Farsi. So she was addressing her own people. And so I can imagine that that might have been part of it.
Yeah, I think it was somebody that was jealous of her. Because I've heard of other cases on YouTube where there will be somebody, they have the followers, they have the monetization, but somebody complains about their channel and their channel's taken down for this mysterious reason for a few days. And there was another thing in the vegan community with this guy. He would antagonize people, but he wasn't saying anything that was illegal. He just was antagonizing people with his odd opinions. So somebody, I guess, that had clout with YouTube had his channel taken down for a while. So that was another controversy that I've heard about. And in other communities too, like I have heard about where two people, they don't agree, and then somebody knows somebody at YouTube and they get it taken down. And that seems to be a thing where a lot of channels are taken down for mysterious reasons, but there's really not a clear explanation, or videos seem to be filtered. I mean, there are some valid points that she's making despite the horrible thing that she did.
Yeah.
I just feel... Well,
what does it actually mean when videos are filtered? What does that mean?
That means that it's not being shown to people that are under 18, and you have to sign into YouTube and you have to click OK. So it's not being shown to a general audience. So your views will be much lower than if it were just to a general audience where you don't have to log in and you don't have to have a YouTube account verifying that you're over 18. That's what happened in her case. Because they said her content was adult content. So when it was being targeted as being, you know, adult content, she can't have ads on it. The general public can't be watching it unless they're over 18 and they have an account where they can log in to watch it. That was her, one of her complaints, I suppose. That, from what I gather from the brief amount of reporting there is on this event, there isn't a lot of actual reporting about what happened behind the scenes, which I find kind of mysterious. I don't know why they haven't really covered it more. Maybe it's because YouTube's embarrassed about some of these things coming to light.
Yeah, it sounds as though there's something proprietary right now going on with that, and maybe they'll never tell us about it. And because there aren't people going into the streets and protesting about it, it's just going to go away, and we're going to forget about it very fast.
Which, to me, is disappointing, because despite all of this outlier event with the horrible result, like, I feel bad for what happened to those people. But the thing that bothers me just about the demonetization is a lot of people do make some of their living with YouTube, and why take away the monetization?
Right.
I don't really see the point for that, you know?
When I was asking in a group of people, you know, I said, of course what she did was terrible and she should not have done it, but and I was still wondering why she lost her revenue. And somebody answered me, well, they had every right to take her revenue away because she wasn't an employee. And I don't understand why this whole issue of being an employee has anything to do with it. You can have all sorts of contractual relations to earn money with an entity or another person. And you don't necessarily have to be an employee for this income to be important to you.
Of course not. And I feel like this is one thing our society is kind of pushing. They want everybody to be an employee of an organization, being self-employed or pursuing your own contracts, whatever they may be, seems to be discouraged because you're not becoming part of, like, just conformist society, which might be another thing that got to her, because maybe people thought, well, she doesn't do this, and that got to her because it was her income and she was apparently doing well at one time. And if you lose all your income and it goes down to 10 cents, maybe that does trigger something in your mind that makes you very upset. I mean, I wouldn't have that reaction, but I would be upset, you know?
Yeah, me too. Yes. You know, I read an interesting article about that vaccination. It's actually about aluminum in vaccines today, and I shared it on Facebook. And it's not so much that I want to talk about the content of the article. The article has a lot of scientific citations in it, and if you are interested, you should read it. But the weird thing that happened is that right after that, I got a notice from Facebook saying that they were going to, they wanted me to know, well, I can look at the, I made a copy of the exactly what it is they said. So I'm going to look at it so I can actually tell you what they did say. They said, here's how we're working to address false news. Aya, we want you to have access to trusted news sources. One way we're working to address false news is by partnering with independent third-party fact checkers to review news stories and rate their accuracy. We'll also notify you if you try to share a story that's been determined to be false. The Facebook help team. Oh, isn't that scary?
That is. That kind of sounds like we live in a fascist regime and we have people that will tell you what you can share and not share. That's kind of like, that's kind of the vibe I get. That's, I mean, really, like, why can't you just share? And by the way, there are valid points because there are, they say you shouldn't wear deodorant that has aluminum in it. And I've been buying like the Schmitz deodorant, because it doesn't have aluminum in it and it has natural ingredients. So that, why would you want to purposely be having more aluminum in your body? That's a good point about that article. I don't see why that's considered false news. It's science.
Well, it was based on a scientific article where they did studies on the brains of autistic people who had died, and they cut open the brains and they found in this particular region that it was full of aluminum and that the brains were inflamed with aluminum. And there's only one way they could have gotten that aluminum. And it's not just like aluminum that we put on our body with deodorant or that we might have on our food. When it's injected into our body and it's done in order to activate the immune system. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what causes it to go past the brain the blood-brain barrier, which normally protects us. Even if we do ingest some aluminum, it never gets to our brain because there are things in our body that will clean it out. But when it's made in such a way that it goes into the vaccine, it's a much the particles are such that our general cleanup cannot work, and it goes past the blood-brain barrier. And it goes into the brain and it causes inflammation and chronic inflammation of the brain. So that was what the article was about. And it was based on quite a number of scientific studies, all of them not done in the United States, many of them in Britain, one of them in China. And so that was what that was about. And until I posted that article on Facebook, I never got a notice about this stuff, about how they were going to check if the articles I post are true.
Hmm. Wow. That's just, I don't think that's right. And why, and even if somebody doesn't agree with an article, why can't they just let people post on Facebook what they want? I don't know why we need somebody to babysit what people post. And that's a valid scientific article, it sounds like to me. Maybe some people have reservations about wanting to have certain vaccines, and that's okay. Like, can't you make these decisions for yourself? Or is it because somebody might not want to do what is mandated, I guess. It's interesting.
So did you have some topics you wanted to raise besides these?
Well, I guess one thing I would talk about, and I thought I would never talk about this, is, you know, what do you think about, like, gossip in social situations? Do you think, like, openly gossiping about someone is helpful? Like, if you're, I don't want to go into too much context about the situation, but if somebody's just gossiping about someone within earshot, is that a positive behavior? That's just one thing I've been thinking about.
No, it's good. There's no reason to gossip. It's actually, if you have something to say about someone, it is good to say it to their face, but to sit around and gossip where they can hear you gossiping, it sounds like that is an attempt to make somebody feel bad. You know,
it's
bullying.
Yeah, it is bullying. But sometimes it gets to the point that if somebody tells you that and you try to discuss with them and then they shush you and, oh my gosh, like, but, you know, I'm probably going to have to just do something about that. But yeah, that's just one topic. I don't want to go into too much detail about that, but yeah. And then what else was I going to discuss? There's an update to 23andMe, which was kind of interesting. I think some of the updates a little accurate, but some of it isn't. Some of it's disappointing because 23andMe said they're going to update their whole test. And even if you took the test previously, it was going to match you more closely with different populations. So I got two closer matches. It said with my Middle Eastern content, I'm very closely related to Lebanon, which makes sense because Anshara, it's near Lebanon, and some of my ancestors lived in Russia, which is in current Lebanon. It's really the same region, and Great Britain. But the part that I didn't really agree with was they put me into this broadly European category once again, and they didn't. So the test still has some issues. So I was kind of interesting, but still kind of disappointed because I thought, oh, they're going to pinpoint things a little bit more. But at least it's an update, so that was kind of interesting. So if you're thinking about the 23andMe test, they have updated it, but I'm not sure I would pay for that one as opposed to Ancestry. I think the Ancestry test is still a little bit better at this point. I wouldn't pay for 23andMe because they don't, if you're into genealogy, they don't have like a way to build a family tree, and they match you with your cousins, but nobody really talks to each other on there, so. That was one update with that I just wanted to share. And I don't really have a lot of other topics. Were there any other topics about things going on this week that you wanted to discuss?
Well, I mean, I'm interested in the ancestry thing. I haven't done it yet. And The one thing that has me on the fence is the issue of privacy, who they're going to share that information with. And whether they are going to, you know, charge me to see it. And then if I don't pay to see it, I don't get to see it anymore. Whereas it will be proprietary for them. That's kind of what I'm wondering about.
Yeah, I think that's pretty much, you're right. I know a lot of people, they will not do any of the ancestry tests because yes, they do sell the information. They strip out the personal information is what they claim, and it's just an aggregated result to supposedly help pharmaceutical companies develop better medicines and vaccines. So it's a little controversial. Some people don't want to participate. What might be nice is if there was a third party entity which would do this that wouldn't sell your information. So maybe in the future they'll develop something like that. There just isn't that service as of yet. But I could see that in the next 10 years, maybe something that's even more accurate than what we have now, which will give you privacy, might come along. So maybe it's better to wait and see, you know, there will be a lot of advances. And like I was saying, I thought this update was going to be so much better than it was, but it was kind of weak in a way because it's still putting me into these broad categories where I know that I have like some German ancestry and some Italian ancestry, but it can't pinpoint that on their reference panel. But supposedly they now have this really robust reference panel, but the update didn't show that. It just said, we see that you have ancestors in Britain and ancestors in Lebanon. But I think that's almost a little bit inaccurate because it seems like I have more ancestors from Germany and the Netherlands than Britain. So I don't know. It depends on, I still think it has a long way to come. I think just making a family tree might be the most interesting part of the experience. So, but the privacy thing is definitely an issue. A lot of people will not take the test because of the reasons that you stated.
Yeah, yeah. I'm still on the fence on that. So I thought I would share this painting, since we don't have a lot of other topics, but this is the painting that I used to market my very, very short story F about the girl in high school who couldn't get her diploma because she got an F in sex education. So
I need to finish reading the story. It's a very interesting story, though.
Yeah, thank you. If any of our viewers want to get that story, it's only 99 cents, so it's pretty affordable.
That's true. That's true. Maybe I was wondering, do you think you'll be writing any more short stories in the future? Maybe about some of the current things going on? That might be interesting, or not yet.
Well, you know, the stories come to me when they come to me, and I don't actually schedule when I'm going to write about something, especially not a short story or a poem. So when I feel absolutely that I have to, that's when I write. So it's different from just working at it. Of course, there is some work involved, but if I don't have the inspiration, then I don't do it at all.
I guess that's another thing. This is just an impromptu thought. Like, do you think with all the changes with Facebook and things that might inspire a story of sorts about civil liberties and the direction of social media and how they try to make us kind of monitored in a way?
Yeah, it's almost 1984 type stuff going on right now. But I'm not sure that I understand it yet. I mean, there's a lot that's going on that I totally do not understand. It's almost like, is there a place where all these guys meet, to decide what the rules are going to be about what we're supposed to know, what we're not supposed to know, what we're supposed to say, what we're not supposed to say? Is it related to the government? Is it really free enterprise? I don't know. And until I understand it, until it pops into my head, I'm not going to write about it because I need to understand.
I was just kind of curious. Oh, here's something else that I was thinking about. One of my friends, she's been talking about dreams and like the different meanings behind dreams. And I thought that was kind of fascinating. Like, do you know anything about that? Like the different meanings behind dreams? Is that something that you're like kind of familiar with? I thought that was just kind of fascinating. Just some of the research about how sometimes dreams can give you an insight into something going on in your mind.
Well, I can tell you an example. This is totally anecdotal. It's not, I don't have a theory about it, you know, for everybody, but a very long time ago, when Bo was still a baby, and he was sleeping in a playpen in my room, and I was folding laundry, and I noticed that my ruby ring was missing. And this was a ring that my grandmother had given me. It was a real ruby, and I was really sad because I wanted to give it to Sword. I had this all worked out. Sword and I have the same birth month. So it was my birthstone. And I was going to give it to her when she grew up. But I wasn't going to give it to her before then because she needed to be responsible before I could give it to her. And then I looked down and my ring was missing. And I didn't know where it was. And I looked all over for it. And I was so sad, and I felt so irresponsible myself, because here I thought that I was going to give this to her when she's responsible, and I lost it. But it was just in the house. We hadn't gone anywhere. And Bo was asleep in the playpen, and he had a pillow. And the next morning, oh, okay, so here's the dream that I had. At night, I dreamt that a black bird had taken my ring to its nest, and it had hidden it in its nest. Well, the next morning, I woke up, and I went and I picked Bo up, and I moved some of the stuff that was in the playpen, his blanket and his pillow, and I think he had it inside his pillowcase. That's where the ring was. So I felt as if my dream that this big black bird had stolen my ring and put it in its nest, I felt that it was telling me where the ring was.
That's pretty, I think so, right? I think that's pretty neat. I hope you find it in a way.
Well, I did. So I was able to give it to Sword when she turned 18.
Wow. That's pretty neat.
But no, I don't have a theory about that. Do you?
I don't per se, but they were just some of the people they were talking about dreams. They were saying how it seemed like some dreams would kind of like almost foretell events in their life. And I haven't really had a predictive dream, but I would always have this weird dream where I'd be running to go somewhere, either to a class because I was late or something, and then I'd fall and wake up. And it just seems like I kind of get the idea. I think it's just that maybe I'm a little anxious and I worry about being places on time. So I don't have like these really deep philosophical dreams, but I do think sometimes in my dreams, these themes of I always want to be on time come up. So, but they were just talking about how some of their dreams would predict events in their life. I was like, oh, that's pretty interesting. Or they were having dreams about how they, about like politics and different things. So I was like, oh, that's kind of, I don't go that deep into the dream analysis. I was just curious, like how familiar you were with the topic. It's just something
that I used to keep a dream diary when I was younger. I was a teenager at that time, but and some of the dreams were pretty elaborate. It really depends on when you wake up. If you wake up when you're in the middle of a dream, you remember it. But if you wake up, you know, and not during your dream cycle, then usually you won't remember that you dreamed. And a lot of people don't think they dream at all because they don't wake up during the dream.
That's probably true. Most of my dreams too, they would just be kind of random things where I'd become different people within the dream. But that was just one random topic. One thing I guess that I might share this week is, are more people talking about leaving Facebook? Is this like a mass exit at this point? Like on your end, have you had more people just leave? I haven't seen more people leave, but it seems like a few people have left.
A few people have left, and some people who are, you know, significant in my business and personal life have left. And I'm in touch with those people via email or other social media sites, such as Instagram. But by and large, most of us have stayed. And I think it's also the same with YouTube. You know, I was pretty upset that YouTube cut my revenue. I mean, not upset enough to go to California and
no,
do anything.
Yeah, no,
but I was upset. Yeah, I was upset. And yet here I am, I'm not getting paid and I'm still doing this. What do you think about that?
Same. Well, I'm still doing it. It is fun. But then the thing that makes me irritated about that they took away our revenue was that is like they wanted us to enjoy it, but yet they don't want us to profit from it. That part still just bothers me. I'm not as upset as I once was, but I remember being really upset that day when they said they were taking our demonetization away. I can see how that might make somebody snap. I would never snap, but I do kind of I'm not leaving YouTube, but I can understand, like, if you were on the edge of something, why that might be something that would trigger that in your mind, you know? And I'm going to stay with YouTube. I don't think I'm going to try, like, the other video platforms because they're pretty clunky. There's really no competitor for YouTube right now. Same with Facebook.
I think we need that. We need a competitor, a genuine competitor for YouTube. And then we'll have a choice. But right now we have no choice. And the same thing is true for Facebook. Yeah, every once in a while, some other thing comes around. Mm-hmm. But it's not the same.
No, it's not. Now, somebody was saying, I noticed on their Facebook feed that there's this new app you can download to your phone and that you can make a few cents with videos here and there. But then again, I don't know about that because it just sounds like another version of the Blues or whatever platform where they pay you for a little while and then it just dissipates. So would you ever think about joining like another app to make videos to see if you can make a few cents here and there?
I'll tell you what I would want to do. I would want to have a platform that could do streaming videos just like YouTube. I would be willing to, you know, invest in that. I would be willing to raise funds from other investors. That's what I would want to do. You know, when HubPage is kind of turned on us, and it used to be such a great site, and then it became a terrible site. I thought, well, I'm going to start another content sharing site. Yeah. And that's when I started PubWages. Now, obviously, I don't have the know-how that the people at HubPages have. And when I did that, I had people saying to me, oh, well, that's just another WordPress site. Why should we join there? But that was my hope. My hope was that we could all continue doing what we did at HubPages on my site, on other sites.
Yeah.
And Google made that impossible because we don't get I don't think we get indexed in the same way that we got indexed on HubPages.
I don't think so, but I was going to ask you this. Do you have some articles that seem to do a little bit better on PubWages, just out of curiosity? Like, has anything stood out that gets a little bit more traffic than some of the other articles?
It's my art articles. You know, like I did an article about how I did this painting. Mm-hmm. In fact, I had several articles because remember I used I used a primer instead of white paint at one point when I was painting this. So I wrote an article about how I goofed, and then I wrote another article about how I came back and finished the painting. And that did really well. I think a lot of people stumbled on it and stumble upon. And I don't know why.
Well, that's one thing I like about stumble upon is once in a while, I'm not sure what article it will be, but something will just become wildly popular. It tends to be like an art related topic because that's a very visual site. Like from what I've noticed from everything I've stumbled, the articles that tend to do the best will be something that's art related, but it's very random what it will be. Like it'll be something that I might not even be that excited about. But your painting's pretty cool. I like that group. Maybe in the future you'll do more of those. That would be kind of interesting.
I mean, even the one I don't know where I put it, but the one with the deer and the butterfly, mm-hmm. that got a lot of views.
Yeah, it's so nice. I think it's pretty cool. Oh, yeah, that was what I was going to talk about. The funniest article, like, on my stories, like, a lot of them you skip views. But the one lately that's just going crazy sauce is this one about how I microwaved a Beast Burger. And I don't think it's because people want to do that to eat it. I think they think it's, like, something silly or funny to do as an experiment. And I've been noticing, like, these experiment videos or articles tend to be really popular, but really strange things like, what will happen if you put some random thing in a waffle iron or something really strange? And I'm like, because, I don't know, it just seems like it's more like people are curious, like, random curiosity not because they want to eat that. Actually, this is kind of funny because when I looked at my analytics, there was somebody staying at a hotel that that Googled how to microwave a beast burger, and I was like, oh, I guess my weird experiment helped them. Maybe. That, well, I would never buy it again. And yeah, it was more traffic, I guess. But it's the most random thing. Like, I never would have thought that would be the most popular article on that blog right now. But it's got like 20 page views every day lately. It's
very well, it's kind of like on YouTube, my most popular video for the longest time was Bo eating a banana, you know, and he would think, well, you know, it's not that big a deal, is it?
But it must be interesting for the average person that's interested in chimpanzees, or maybe just random people. That was another thing I was going to notice. It seems like you do have a lot of fans who are interested in your in Bo. Like, have you been doing any more videos with him this week? Or
I didn't have time. I was very busy with quite a number of other projects, so I didn't have time. I feel kind of guilty that I didn't do it, but you know what, I'm not being paid. I got demonetized. Mm-hmm. So
there you go. Yeah, you have to do other projects right now. Like, if you're not. So, YouTube's kind of missing out in a way. But the funny thing is, I'm not making more videos. But on that second video channel, the hair channel, like, I'm getting more subscribers lately. But, oh, this was a funny topic that I do actually want to share. I have this guy that's very interested in people sending him wigs, hair, so he can make wigs. So he wanted me to save all my hair that comes out of my hairbrush so I could mail it to him so he could make a wig, which I'm not really interested, but I don't want to save hair. So I told him, just to be funny, I said, well, why don't you send me an envelope every day and I'll send you all the hair out of my hairbrush every day for a year? And he said, no, that's too expensive. For the same price, I could just ask anybody to sell me their ponytail. And I'm like, I said, well, then why are you commenting on my video? And he says, you insulted me. And I was like, okay. That was just kind of random and funny. But
yeah, I would not send hair to anybody, and I'll tell you why.
No.
That's your DNA in there. And if they wanted to get at a crime scene or whatever, I just wouldn't do that.
Oh, I'm not doing it. I find it very creepy, honestly. Like, why would you want somebody's hair? I was actually just joking with the guy because it's a strange comment.
But yeah.
It's a little strange. I was like, no, you're absolutely right. It's just like, okay. I get some nice comments, but sometimes I get some really strange ones. That's a pretty strange comment. I don't even think he's a wig maker. I think he's one of these people that have, that's fine. He just wants people to send him hair. But that was kind of funny. And then I just had people that were like arguing with old comments that I made a long time ago. Nothing real exciting. But I have been ignoring it and just haven't responded because I don't know why you're arguing with some comment I made a year ago on some random video. So.
Well, obviously there are a lot of people with a lot of time on their hands.
Yeah, I think that's what it is. And anyway, like you said, we're not being paid to add content to YouTube anymore, so there really isn't as much of an incentive, except for the live streams, which we enjoy doing. And I was going to ask you, because I know you mentioned that there's another person that might be doing a live stream with us. Are you able to talk about that yet, or just so?
Well, tentatively, it's going to be on the 20th, but I don't want to jinx it by talking about
it. I know, that's the thing. I would like more people to join our live streams, but I feel like it's really difficult to get people to commit to a certain date, perhaps.
Yeah,
I really wish people would. I think it'd be interesting, you know, to have like an alternative to some of the other debating pages, but I don't think we're the only ones, actually, because like I was telling you, there's this other guy, he's a pretty big YouTuber, he has like 127,000 followers, and he'll go on all the time and he'll try to get people to debate the other side of his belief, and he has a really hard time trying to get people to come on to debate with him. So I don't think we're the only ones. It might just be hard to get people to come on to these events, perhaps.
Well, you know, Sue was very good, and she said that she would, you know, she would be willing to do it again. So,
Yeah, definitely. That's, I think so. I mean, that's a plus, you know. But I thought what she said was really interesting. I hope more people actually watch that video. That
I think a lot of interest. They will eventually.
Yes, I think they will. I think they just need to find it, maybe. I guess that's another thing I was going to ask. Are there any other social media platforms besides Twitter and Facebook and Google Plus that you're using at this time?
That I mean, Instagram.
Instagram.
Yeah, I don't use Pinterest as much as I used to.
I used to use it. Oh, that was another thing I was going to talk about. Okay, they took Polyvore away, but I totally get it in this case. Like, a lot of people were really upset about that. It was a site where you could share, like, products that you like, and a lot of people used it for marketing reasons, and I do think I sold some things on Zazzle via Polyvore, but it did have a big copyright issue because there were people that were stealing images from many third-party sites, and Polyvore wasn't monitoring what was being uploaded to their website. So now they've become more of an exclusive style collection site. That's why Polyvore went away. But I don't think you were ever on there, were you?
I was not, but you were actually helping me out. You were selling some of my shirts there.
Yeah, I was, and I liked that. I do miss that part that we can't market ourselves on there anymore. There's supposedly another site that's like it, but I'm probably not going to join it because how long is that one going to last? So now with Instagram, this is the interesting thing with my phone. I guess this is another thing I can talk about. I haven't wanted to upgrade my phone yet. I have the same Android phone since July of 2016. I have to take apps on and off if I want to use them. In order to use Instagram or Messenger, I have to sometimes take Messenger off so I can use Instagram. Then I have to take Messenger off so I can, you know, go back and forth because my phone doesn't have enough memory. Like, it has a very little memory, which kind of... So I'm thinking about this. Does the iPhone... You own an iPhone. Are you able to have a lot of apps on there?
I am intentionally limiting myself on that because I love to use my iPhone as a camera. I love to take pictures of Bo and outdoors and the cockatiels, and I take movies on it. So I do have some apps, but I'm limiting it on purpose. The apps that I have right now are Facebook, Instagram, Messenger, and YouTube. Plus, I had the Family Link when Bo had his tablet, which, by the way, he destroyed. But one of my viewers has said that she would send us a tablet. So we're looking forward to that.
Oh, that's exciting. Now, I have WhatsApp on my phone. That might be something that takes up a lot of space. But I do like WhatsApp because some people I know abroad, they feel like Facebook is too invasive, so they only want to use WhatsApp because WhatsApp ensures your privacy, and they would prefer to only message me on there. And I have some friends who refuse to join Facebook, and they're only on WhatsApp. So I can't get rid of WhatsApp. I have to keep that app on my phone. So I have to swap the other ones back and forth. But I am thinking about getting a new phone eventually because this gets kind of annoying to go back and forth between apps. But I guess I'll wait and see. But WhatsApp would be really cool if it was some sort of a social networking site, but I know they're never going to be because the whole premise behind them is they actually protect your privacy, but you can't share anything there with the public. It's just a way to message your friends, like friends who don't want to be on Facebook, essentially. Because they...
Well, my friends who are not on Facebook, I just message them through text on their phone.
Mm-hmm. I would do that, but my... some of my friends live internationally, and it would cost money to do an international text plan or like for me to respond to them. So I can't do that because I only have domestic text texting, or they don't really want to text, like do general texts, but they like WhatsApp because it has the little emojis. So they want the Facebook experience without being on Facebook, I guess. I guess that's the appeal of WhatsApp. It has a few cool features on there, but it's just like Messenger, essentially. But some people I know, they don't want to be on Facebook because they're concerned about the privacy issues. But they want the experience of Facebook, so they're on WhatsApp. But that thing eats up a lot of data on your phone, so that's just my annoyance with it. But that's just one random topic that I kind of thought was interesting. Was there anything else that you wanted to talk about tonight?
Well, no, I think we pretty much covered everything that I had prepared for tonight. I would like to learn more about green screens, but presumably neither of us really know much about that right now.
Yeah, that's true. But anyway, maybe we can think about some more topics for next week, and I'm hoping, like, maybe rescheduling people that I was real excited. Hopefully we'll have more commitments for future guests. But Sue will definitely be on, so that's something to look forward to.
Yes, Sue will definitely be on, and that's something to look forward to.
Well, I really like your lamp. It looks nice, so nice.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. So anyway, have a good night, Aya.
Okay, good night, Julia.
Bye.
Bye.